so we're gonna listen to it, and I'll play the score, or put the score up here, and then I'll do my best attempt to follow along. Structured arrangement of Gills and a really well written one. am very successful, even though it is actually fairly simple. Morning. So are there any things, like, first observations that you guys have before I tell you all the answers? None? Like, just what makes that a great chart? Why do people like that chart?
Grooves.
It grooves? Yeah.
The tuba has the melody.
Well, of course. Well, what, expand on that. Because that there's more to it than just the tuba has the melody.
Well, the tuba has the melody, and then it eventually splits up, so the horns are playing the melody, like I think it's five or six, while it's harmonized with like just the trumpet on top by the end of it.
Yeah, I mean, basically, one of the, like, as far as like kind of like an overall arc of the chart, I think that really is successful is he builds the climax orchestrationally as well as harmonically and everything. So, like you said, the very first thing you hear is you have the tuba playing the melody. So the tuba, you know, down here in the basement. Then the next thing that you hear is a trombone solo. So you move from the basement to like first level, mezzanine, whatever. And then the next thing you hear is he's got the band voiced out in five voices, trumpet with the lead. So it's like he's building these stair steps as he builds into the climax. And instead of what I think is really great and what I've mentioned to you with your chart, and I talk to everybody about, is modulation. So he's built these stair steps building up into the featured soloist of the record, Cannonball. And instead of just bringing Cannonball in, he actually modulates and moves to a different key. And then, so then you have these stair steps. And then by the time you get there, you've got your climax with the band doing their thing. And then he just quick goes complete reverse from the, you know, the highest note, I think, of the chart, that F sharp or whatever that's in the trumpet, and he goes down to that pedal in the bass, or on all the trombones. You know, so he's built this whole thing up, and then he does, so he has a visual auditory arc to the whole thing, you know, where he builds these stair steps. So I think that's one of the reasons that you feel like, you know, you're going somewhere. The chart has direction, and he does it purely with, you know, planning what instruments are playing the melody and anything like that. Anything else that do you think? I can always just tell you the answers to if you guys don't guess. I think another really successful thing with this is that there's not a lot of information here. I mean, as far as like motives. So, you know, these are just pure, you know, background pads. But he's got this little figure here. Oh, look at that. That's not what I wanted to do, but it's fun. He's got this little figure here with the hits on four, and he introduces it in the guitar, and then you have it here in the trombones, and he does it again later, and he does it once it modulates into Cannonball's key. You have that kind of, like, hit on four. I mean, if you wanted to, you could actually, like, write down, like, the four things that really make up this arrangement, and then how he just keeps using them in different ways and developing them. So there's that kind of thing. There's this figure which he uses as a send-off into Cannonball, a send-off into the trombone solo, and then the whole big climactic moment at the end. He has this, where is it? I mean, this is a development of that, of those hits on four. You know, that figure he uses, and actually what's interesting, if you look at everything from this record, do you guys know what record, this is from New Bottle Old Wine, which was released just recently, like a few years ago, as a two-disc set with Blue Note called The Complete Pacific Jazz Recordings. It's a killing record, two records actually. But he uses this figure kind of throughout different pieces on this album, so it actually gives the album kind of a cohesiveness as well. And he uses a lot of like chromaticism. You'll see those like chromatic lines in the horn and everything like that, that are also used kind of throughout the record. But anyway, so there's those kind of figures that are brought in. This is kind of the linear directional thing that he uses kind of throughout the record. But anyway, it's those kind of things. And if you think about it, he's got, you know, those hits on four, for instance. Like I said, the first time it was guitar, Second time it was in the trombones. He does it, I think, a third time, and he changes it and he adds like a couple of Harmon muted trumpets. So he's using the same material, but changing it ever so slightly, either by instrumentation, orchestration, some slight rhythmic change, like I.
It's a similar thing, it's just one of those things, you know.
Yeah.
It's the same kind of.
Yeah, it's the same kind of concept. So, my point that I'm trying to get across is like when I go and hear a lot of people's music and they have me, you know, they play me some things, they do a lesson or whatever. They usually the more is more kind of mentality. You know, it seems like everyone takes like the kitchen sink and throws it into an arrangement because they think that that somehow is better. But. And I was in the same mentality too before I started really studying Gil's music and realizing that you can make a chart sound new and inventive by taking just a few little motives and reworking them in different ways and being creative with just this one little material. And besides, if you think about it from a listening standpoint, you know, even though you guys probably weren't cued into it because you're tired and slightly hungover and not really paying attention to it. Just kidding. Both Doug and I, when you picked me up, were like, "Oof! All right, here we go. Shake off the cobwebs." But you know, it gives the listener something to latch onto, even though they might not be even consciously being like, "Oh yes, there's that motive again." You know, I enjoy listening to that motive. You know, so but I mean, like these little offbeat things, and they're all, I mean, like this introduces kind of the hemiola. He takes the four, you know, it's the hits on four all the time. Then he takes this and he kind of creates a hemiola that eventually turns into here's the hits on four, and then he develops that into this three over four hemiola. So he's connecting these things even though you may not be aware that he's actually doing it. And again, I mean, if you look at pure, I mean, some people are like pure numbers. If you look at pure numbers of bar numbers, or, you know, numbers of measures that he's used this motive within the piece. You know, and if you're writing on a deadline or something like that, I mean, he's used up half the chart with just this kind of hits on four and developing that. And they're just triads, you know, in different inversions. There's nothing, you know, rocket science about it. So that's the kind of thing that I always look at with the chart, especially with Gil's, is his use of material. And who knows, I mean, people always ask me, I never met the guy, so I don't, chance to ask him, but they always ask me, you know, was he conscious of these things or was he just kind of doing it? And I think it was probably a little bit of both, you know, kind of like a second nature. You know, he had this, but also, you know, he really was the type of person to come up with something and just do one slight little note difference or something like that to really alter, you know, the whole thing. And I'll show you a little bit later. So, and Bob was the same way. You know, Berkmeyer. He said there was one lesson that I saw him do at Eastman, maybe, or NEC, I can't remember. Kid brought a piece in, and Bob's, you know, sat there and listened to it. It was like 10 minutes long. It was way too long. But, and Bob was listening to it, and he said, his only comment to the kid was, like, I could eat from that chart. How did he say it? It was a great line. He said, I could eat from that chart for the rest of my life. And he basically meant, like, he had enough information within that chart that Bob could make every piece that he needed to for the rest of his life. And it's true. You know, like, are you familiar with Bob's work that he did with the Metropole Orchestra, the music for string quartet and orchestra? And it's a really beautiful piece he did in, I can't remember when, mid to, so 2000s. But the second movement, it's called American Beauty. Is almost 20 minutes long, I think. It's really long. And the entire piece, the entire movement, is based off of a major second. That's the only thing that he based the entire thing off of, was just one interval. And he created a 20-minute work off of this one interval. And that's the kind of development within your writing that you really have to strive for. And I think I'm kind of jumping aside from Gil a little bit, but I think like as you're writing like a technique thing, you know, I mean, that really, when I start writing, I have a big notepad on my piano, and I just make small little motives, like kind of playing around, just finding little things that kind of inspire me and things that I want to develop. And then I pick one, and I see how far I can kind of take it, do different exercises, develop it, treat a melodic thing as harmony, or harmony as melody, harmony as rhythm, harmony, you know, those kind of things, taking the numbers of the intervals and turning them into rhythm, doing all just different sorts of things to make development out of these things. So if you're making like a typical, as, you know, what I hate calling this typical, but a straight ahead kind of swing arrangement of something, you know, to take a development figure, and I think you guys probably heard that because most of you guys were in the band or whatever, were at the concert. I mean, with all that music that we did, you know, they all have that kind of connected, you always kind of just, like, the piece never feels like it goes, it, like, keeps going, it always just kind of has this thing that grounds it, and I think, and he can go away and add new things here and there, but yeah, so I think that's an important part of this chart and a lot of Gil's writing. Yeah, so does anyone have any questions so far before I keep going with this? So, speaking of kind of Gil as development things and less is more kind of things. So, do you know, what's the name of it? Las Vegas Tango? Do you guys know that tune of Gil's? So it starts, I mean, I could play it, but then I'll give away the answer. Okay, so, so this is just kind of a development and a writing thing. So Las Vegas Tango starts with a triad. It's E minor triad. So we're going to play a little game. Okay, so E minor triad. So how would you voice an E minor triad? There's not too many options. Right? Okay. So, Gil always, and Gil takes this with everything. I mean, we can find examples of this everywhere. I love this tune. So Gil has this E minor triad that he wants to do. And those are his options. So we'll stick with this. I mean, you can do it here. It doesn't really matter. Gil chose this. Was it second inversion? Mm-hmm. Is that what they call it? So, second inversion. So how do you make that sound interesting?
Spread it out.
Spread it out. Awesome. That's what's not what I was expecting to hear, but I like it. So, there's that. You can... that alone, and that's something that Gil used a lot, was he used space within his writing and within the notes to create a fuller sound. I mean, that automatically sounds more full than that, right? The other thing is, I mean, you're allowed to add a note. So Gil adds a note. What note would you add to this to make that fun? There's really no wrong answer.
The nine.
What do you want?
Let's do the ninth.
Let's do the ninth. Well, I default to the, of course, the half step on the top. But so there. Oh wow, ninth. That's what you get when you. Okay. So anyway, so yeah, so you get that. You can move it down. Fun, right? Now what Gil does for this is he does the major seventh. So he makes, which he used a lot, that was his kind of like go-to minor chord. So the options of voicing, which is a typical, if you heard that, you would think, it's a little Gil, right? It's a Gil voicing. What Gil did, similar to what I did with the ninth, he puts it and creates the minor ninth within the piece. And he takes that whole thing and he planes it. All diatonic. But he creates these you know, as parallel octaves or parallel ninths or whatever. But I mean, that's what
is so amazing to me is that if I were sitting there and I was like, okay, I'm going to write this arrangement, I was like, oh, it's an E minor, you know, I would come and I would do, put E in the bass, you know, and all, sure, we'll do that. That's on top because it's the fun note, you know. I probably would have done that. But anyway, but to me, that, I mean, that's works. It's the same kind of thing. It has kind of the grit of the seconds and everything in there. But it's so heavy and it's so full. But you do this, you know, you hear so much more of that interval. And when you play it, you know, with the band, and I'll play the track, but that has so much resonance to it, and the resonance comes from space. So again, here's the less is more Gil Evans approach to voices, is you start with a triad, and then you find the fun note. That's equally as fun. But you know what it does, is it doesn't, it's still kind of a close voicing. You know, this adds a little bit of space, you know, outside of that kind of, I mean, even though that's outside of an octave, but it's basically an octave. So this, I mean, you can hear the difference, you know, between that. So yeah. So that kind of mentality. It's the same thing as, well, I'll talk about that. So anyway, so let me quick play.
Can I ask you a question about that, Ryan?
Sure, absolutely.
How does that voicing exist inside of that arrangement? Is anybody playing anything lower than that D sharp on the bottom? Or?
I'm going to play it for you. Basically, the whole thing starts with him playing just what I did on piano. And then he basically orchestrates it. And as he builds it, he basically just takes this, and then, you know, he'll build around those things, and I think he adds, you know, so as the chart builds, he adds more people to it. But it's really, you guys just did charts, I think, for five horns, but it was all linear, right? Like, you couldn't use harmony, it had to be lines. All of a sudden, it was just the white snow that I saw on the computers. Let me find it there. It's on a record that you should all own. It should be like required listening. It's called The Individualism of Gil Evans. How many of you have heard of that record? Oh, okay, that's good. That's good. It's an amazing record. I don't have a score to this, sorry. A groove, and then he uses the same thing, and he builds the whole thing, he develops the whole voicings, and he just fills it in with the instruments. And then when he needs to fill it out, you'll hear it. He adds just a few more notes of the same triad, you know, or the same minor ninth that's in there. And is this like life-changing, kind of like game-changing arranging? No. But it's hugely successful as a chart. And I mean, I get shit all the time for not playing this too. People request this all the time. They love this. You know, because it's very simple. It has everything that they need to latch onto as a listener. It has solo space, which is great, so you've got a great soloist. You know, not too shabby here. Who is this? Is this Jimmy Cleveland? I think it is. And even in Gil's piano comedy, you can always hear he always uses just that melody and the kind of harmony that's behind it. And then it's not until he introduces another soloist that you hear some slight variation of anything new. And it really is nothing except for extremely difficult. Chart off of just that voicing, I mean, is pretty incredible to me. I would always want to think like, oh, these people are bored of hearing this over and over and over and over again. But if you do slight variations of it, you know, I mean, even by adding, it's a little, somehow it turns out major. Just by, you know, I'm using the same notes, but just filling out, it fills out the voicing, but you can do that as a development thing. Another prime example, do you guys all know Gil's arrangement of Summertime that he did for Miles? Yes? No? Okay, so that's a prime example of taking, of what Gil was like totally known for, of taking a tune and making it his own somehow, and making people feel like it's his own. On this individualism record, he did an arrangement, Kurt Vile's Barber Song. Have you guys that own it? You heard it? That tune, I always thought was Gil's. I never thought it was anyone other than Gil's. It's just so uniquely him and everything. And if you look at it, and look at Kurt Vile's original, like his original version of it, the voicings that Gil used on that are Kurt Vile's from the printed published lead sheet, 100%. At the beginning, that's all, and then what Gil does is he creates an atmosphere around it. He has the bass flute doing a trill below it. he has this trombone doing this really quiet gliss between a minor third, and those two elements with these voicings, that's all that he needs to create an atmosphere that makes it his own. Summertime is the same thing. For me, maybe I'm a little biased, but for me, when people say, oh, summertime, I immediately go, boo ba doo ba doo ba da, boo ba doo ba doo ba da. And all the Gil does for that whole thing. And then when he has the arrival, instead of hitting, instead of doing that, he adds the spice to it. A little minor second to add a little grit to it, you know. But that's the whole arrangement, is him just using voicing and that rhythmic factor, and then again modulating it when the tune modulates. But then he builds on that and just expands on the orchestration using those things and adds a single note. Like he'll add, I think at one point he adds the ninth. Yeah, I think he adds the ninth in there at one point. And he might add, seventh and the ninth at some point as he develops it, but and he does it in octaves and range and whatever, and yeah, that's basically the whole kind of thing, and that's what I really want to see in people's writing when they do, because I think people focus so much on just like, yeah, I've got this one idea, I'm going to do this for 8 measures, and then I've got to come up with another idea, and then I've got to come up with another idea, and oh my god, the chart's got to be, you know, 10 minutes long, it's got to be 12 minutes long. I mean, as you guys know that played last night, I mean, we did like 15 tunes or 12 tunes or something like that because they're like 4 minutes long. You know, there's nothing wrong with having a 4 to 6 minute tune as long as what you accomplish within that tune is right. It's a tough thing to say, but, you know, in that you use your time that you've borrowed, you know, the ears and the mental capacity of your listeners and your audience to the full extent and make it something that's enjoyable, something that's, you know, you're able to comprehend. And yeah, I think by doing the less is more kind of mentality is important. Does anyone have any questions? We can listen to more stuff. We can still do that. I think another thing that I'll say is, because I'm assuming, even though I know you guys did 4 horn charts now, I'm assuming eventually you'd have to write a big band chart.
They actually did 5 horn charts.
Or 5 horn chart.
Right. And eventually that is the goal here with the last project, is to do the full big band chart.
Yeah, and just from writing for big band, my experience, I actually hate doing it. Sorry.
Why?
Why?
Yeah.
I feel like big band gives you, I think big band locks you into a hole. Kind of backs you into a corner as far as your ability to write, and for me, what I'm interested in as far as orchestrational things and color things and whatever, I feel like the typical 5 saxes, 4 trumpets, 4 trombones, 4 rhythm, it has limitations to it that kind of keep you from exploring and finding new things, and I think that's what Gil did, and Gil was successful with his writing, is that, I mean, there's not a single chart that I have that was written for, well, that's not true. He reorchestrated some stuff for Kendorf because they asked him and they paid him money to do so. But, I mean, he never wrote for typical big band because, like, when you voice a trombone section, for instance, and this is what, when I was writing a lot of big band, this is what I found. I mean, I should get out of E minor.
I'm sorry.
No, I'm okay. I'm just a little dry. Do I sound horrible?
No.
No, I just... anyway, so... I mean, you always are just stuck with kind of the same... You know, it's always, you always kind of where you do... You know, that trombone voicing is only really successful in certain capacities. Band. and this is what I noticed when I was analyzing Gil's music, is that, you know, I would start looking at people's big band writing, and I was studying a lot of big band writing, and all the trombone voicings were starting to come out the same. It was like, oh, I just see it, and I'd be like, yep, that's it, that's it, that's it. You know, oh, they did a fifth in the bass, oh, they did a seventh in the bass, you know, oh, they did an octave, something like that. And then I start looking at Gil's stuff, and you know, like, the Thornhill Orchestra has two trombones, three trumpets, two French horns, and five saxes. So automatically, with three trumpets and two trombones, so you have five brass total, and the trombone players can attest, the trombone parts kind of look like flute parts. You know, because automatically you just have two notes. You can do any two notes and they're going to work on an instrument. But so you have this flexibility all of a sudden with, you can have, you know, treat it like a five trumpet section, so you put the voices like this. You can do four voices, you know, between the three trumpets. You can put the trombone above the trumpet. You can have the trombones with the saxes. You have a horn, so the horn can be this voice here, and you can constantly have all these different changes in color, and it works. There's something too mentally, and I don't know if you find this at all with bands. I find, like, mentally, if you have a trombone section, there's four of them lined up, and I don't mean to pick on the trombones. It works in all instances, the saxes or whatever. When you have a section of them in a big band, there's kind of this mental picture, like, I know what I'm going to be doing. I know my job. When these guys on the other side of me play, I'm going to play. You know, and you immediately single out a trombone and a saxophone and a trumpet or two trumpets or something, and there's a little bit of, like, I don't really, even though you're not conscious of it, it just sounds like people are like, I'm a little uncomfortable that my friends around me aren't playing. You know, and it never really gels, it never seems to work. But, you know, when you put Gil's stuff together, all of a sudden you kind of eliminate any sort of mental, psychological barrier that big band brings in, and you're just like, oh crap, there's an oboe. I've never played with an oboe in a jazz band before. I don't know what's going to happen. This is exciting. You know, there's some sort of psychological thing, whether I'm making this up or not, I don't know, but that's how I've always felt. Whenever I write big band stuff and I try to do, even if I voiced that voicing 100% out for a smattering of instruments in a big band, but everybody else is sitting around there except for the four people playing, versus if there's only like 12 people in a room and there's like a French horn and a tuba and a bassoon and whatever, and I do the same thing, it just sounds better. It feels more comfortable by having just a slightly different kind of psychological surroundings, I guess. And that's kind of my why I don't necessarily like big band, is because there's just kind of that. And it's not that I don't like it, it's just for me as a writer, I would prefer to kind of explore the colors and things that are available to me with the different instrumentation. Because it just seems to, like, it always gets stuck in a little bit of a rut, and there's never, like, too much space that you can really, you know, get away from. So, were there any other questions? I forgot what I was about to do. We were listening to stuff. What were we going to listen to?
What were you talking about with that point in my shit that you said was your favorite orchestration technique?
Oh, it was my favorite orchestrational moment. Okay. Let me find my shit. So, what I love about it, I can't remember, yeah, so there's the tuba part down there, but anyway, so what I love about it is how he basically builds this whole moment into an orchestrated decrescendo. So basically, God, I haven't thought about this in a long time, I hope I don't screw this up. So he's got everyone playing in unison before this, leading up to it. And when he breaks out the voicings, and keep in mind too, this is where the trombones come in as a section with that kind of chorale thing. So he's building up to this moment with the trombones coming in. So the orchestration is dropping off. He's got all the high orchestrations coming low. So instead of, but he's going up in direction with the line and everything. So instead of building up to this big moment and then having the whole thing drop off, but still having that kind of peak to it, he has everyone in unison climbing up. You know, here's the trumpets. The trumpet, oh, it feels expensive. Okay, so, I'm a little ADD, I don't know if you guys can tell. So anyway, so he has the trumpet and the clarinet here in unison going up. And at the peak moment, and he's got other people doubled and whatever, at the peak moment, everybody else moves down in pitch. And the whole chord shifts downwards, except for the clarinet that moves up, and then the bass clarinet with the octave below it. But so he has everyone moving up, and it exposes that lovely clarinet sound. So all of a sudden you lose this double of the clarinet. You know, when you do clarinet and cup mute, it's kind of pseudo-English horn, oboe, kind of soprano vibe to it, as far as the color. And then he has this beautiful pure tone of the clarinet, the no vibrato and everything that shines through it, but everybody else comes down, but that clarinet still goes to that peak. So you have the feeling of it arriving and lifting, yet everything else is coming up and going down to prepare everything for the trombones. So yeah, that was my kind of favorite. And he does it again later, where the horn has a thing, where the horn and the clarinet are together, and then the clarinet goes away and it's just the horn holding on this thing. And it's really beautiful. And again, I mean, not to like just beat you over the head with this, but I mean, like, this is the type of thing that I find in Gil's music that makes it so interesting to me. I mean, when you guys were doing your five horn charts and with just doing lines, you know, you can still do things in unison, you know, like you have like three horns playing a line together, and all of a sudden you change it down to two, and even if you guys are still in unison, the color change of that thing adds change to your writing and changes to the overall thing, so it's going to sound different even though it's really not that different. You know, so just subtle things of having this doubling happening all there, and he removes it just on this one note, you know, is extremely powerful, I think, at least. So yeah, that was that moment in my ship. This was done in, I think, 64, 65, and once he got past, like, the 1950s, like, when he did Out of the Cool, he made a shift in his writing, and he stopped. He always did sketches like this. Did we do Round Midnight when I was here a year ago? So, like, with Round Midnight, that he had the whole thing sketched out like this, but he had his piano part written out in the sketch, but he never put it on a score. So what he would do is he'd start with this just as a sketch form, and then he would move to full score, and he would send the full score off to the copyist, and they would make parts. But Gil always played off of these reductions, because he played on the piano and all those parts. In his later years, when he was a little bit slower with writing, I think, and I don't know what other reason he had, but he stopped going to full score, and he would just do all the orchestration on the sketch. So you see, like, this voicing, it's soprano and oboe on the top note, then trumpet and alto here, horn and tenor, trombone, tenor. And that's how he split up the whole voicings. And it's really kind of not conducive to copyists. It's a pain in the ass to copy music like this, because it constantly switches, and he'll have, you know, voice crossings and things like that that he'll do and whatever. So that's kind of where we're at here. And he always put the instrumentation of the whole thing up there. You know, and when the woodwinds doubled, woodwind 3 to English horn, woodwind 4 to bassoon, woodwind 5 to English horn, whatever. Nice. So we'll listen to it, and then I can talk about this. see in this are things that I've talked about so far. Yeah, exactly. So, I mean, here he's used, I mean, basically a pedal, you know, and the harmony really doesn't change that much. But he starts off, you know, with the low triad, and then he spaces it out, he moves the inversion, and he slowly, you know, he's adding different pitches from the diatonic, you know, scale or whatever, but he's adding space to these intervals until he gets here. Now, what you asked me before with Las Vegas Tango, it was a technique that he used a lot. I think it only is really successful, I mean, you probably would only come to this conclusion of doing it, having Steve Lacy in your band, but he often harmonized above the lead part. So, in this instance, this isn't really a lead part, it's, I mean, the top voice, but I mean, a lot of times the melody note would be here. He does this a lot in Thornhill. And even in Miles and stuff, like the Miles Ahead stuff and Sketches of Spain, you'll have the melody happening here, and then you've got the harmony line, you know, a sixth or something above the part. But he puts the soprano and an oboe on this top note here, and he's got the soprano going up to a high F sharp, his high F sharp. But what it does is it creates that lead part that you need from a trumpet, but without, I mean, you know, to play that on trumpet versus playing that on soprano, you know, it's a different force that you're going to be hit with. You have to put a whole lot more air and pressure in to play this high F sharp like that on trumpet than you would even on soprano. So what he does is he softens the blow, I guess, if you will, by orchestrating the lead part as more of a, there's a brilliant part in, what track is it? Once Upon a Summertime from Quiet Nights, where he does that, and I was doing it with the band, and I sent it ahead of time, and they called me, and they said, the parts are all wrong. You know, they said, we were listening to it, and, you know, on the record, there's supposed to be a trumpet, and the director called me, he says, the parts are wrong, I was listening to it, I was looking at the score, and he said, you know, the trumpet is playing his lead part, and it's not in the part. I said, trust me, go and play it, it's right. And he goes, and he called me back, he goes, you're right, it sounded exactly like it does on the record. And what he does is he has the trumpet like on an A, and then he's got two alto flutes and Steve Lacy on soprano playing this like screaming high part. And it sounds like a trumpet, and it sounds like it fits in the trumpet section. It sounds like this big thing, but it makes it softer. And it's not so like big band, high chord kind of thing. It brings it down a little bit by that. Orchestration that he does. He'll have his cheat. Is there anything else that you noticed? One thing that's pretty obvious to me, he uses it twice, is this kind of like pads in the in either the brass or the woodwinds or something, and then this ascending line. And another important thing I think, and you'll notice this with the guys that played the stuff that we did, of Gill's, is rarely do you have anything that feels like it's ever landing on one. You know, he always tries to avoid one, and I think a big thing that I was taught that helps that, and that's another kind of pet peeve of mine, is that, you know, when I'm judging competitions or whatever, composition competitions, and I sit there, everything, you just always hear the bar line, every time. And even though Gill has got, I mean, this is as bar line as it gets, you know, with these pads, but he throws it off by having this line that never lines up really on one, and it always feels like it's kind of floating, and it's ascending, and it's got this beautiful thing where it starts crossing into the voicing that it has, and it's the same kind of effect, Tom's not here, that the bass clarinet has at the beginning of My Ship, you know, where it's this descending thing and happening in the trumpets, and this bass clarinet kind of comes out of nowhere, and then all of a sudden it's the like peak of the whole thing, and then it comes down and whatever. So, and you can even see kind of like how Gill changed kind of his mind of what was happening. I mean, this was a half note to start with. That was a half note, that was a half note, that was a half note. And you can see he erased the half note here that was a C. So, I mean, he had them as half notes. And then he went in there, because he obviously wanted this ascending line in there, and then went in there and added the rhythms to offset it from the thing. And what happens is, and he uses it verbatim, this whole stuff verbatim, later. Where is it? Here. You know, he uses the whole thing verbatim, the same voicings and everything, but now he's added, instead of just having a bassoon, it's two trombones and the French horn playing this line, and he's offset all these pads, the same voicings that they were before, but he's offset them all. So he's even, you know, twisted rhythmically what he had before, and he adds this really out oboe line on top that, again, kind of all fudges with the time, you know, so you, and that was another thing, like, as far as, like, drumming goes, you know, in this music, it's all time. The drummer was responsible for playing 4-4 or 3-4, whatever it is, he needed that time, because he played with all the rhythmic interactions and everything he did in his writing. And if you started hitting these things, you know, all of a sudden you start making these the bar lines and everything kind of gets offset and loses its hipness. But if you have something cooking along in the four, that's the same thing with like the tuba parts or the bass trombone parts. The bass is always playing quarter notes, but you'll be playing the same notes but on off beats. You know, but the bass and the drums are laying down this tight thing, and so all of a sudden then you're the heating roller effects and all the offbeat rhythms and the hipness of these charts happen off of the time, playing off the time. The other thing that I love with this chart is the shout chorus, which is just like an outer space. But one thing that is just truly amazing with this is he, again, is playing with the rhythmic stuff of this. So here, it's when you start, it's very clear in four. Ba, 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 ba. But immediately, he kind of plays a little bit with this 3-4 hemiola that he has. And then when he hits this beat here, he literally turns the beat around. This automatically becomes, there's a rest here even though you can't see it. This becomes 3. You know, where he's all of a sudden, he's put us in 3-4. So there's bar 3, bar 3, bar 3. There's bar 3, bar 3. You know, and then he starts turning the beat around again and just kind of throwing us all into discombobulation. I mean, it gets out of 3 and it's kind of in 3, kind of in 4. And then he pops back into 4 with that. So he's playing with 3-4, which is the original time signature of this tune. Yeah, I just think it's really brilliant how this whole that whole thing works. And I always, it took me almost 2 years of conducting this chart and playing this chart for me to not to go into 3 at that moment. Like I would always just start going dun, 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 and then I could never get back into it. It was horrible. But anyway, so is there anything else that
actually, now's a good time, if there are any questions, we've got just a few minutes left.
Oh, yeah.
This has just been wonderful. It's spectacular to see all this.
Yeah. Do you guys have any questions about anything? It doesn't have to be what I talked about, writing.
Is this kind of the format he uses for all of his stuff that he writes? That, like, he has just one, like, lead sheet, per se, and then he just has everything written out, or voiced out?
A lot of it. The later stuff, this is all.
Okay.
What's that? What did I talk about before? Round Midnight? So, like, Round Midnight, you know, he has this sketch format. And again, this is piano. That's his part. And he played off of this part at the session. But then, what he did. Then he goes to full score, eventually. But you see when he does the full score that and this is from the copyist. These checks, those are the parts that he's done, making sure that he's done them. But you see, like, there's no piano part, but he blew everything else up to full score to make it easier on the copyist. But that was also that he had time to do that. Which he was still a slow writer, you know, at this point, but he still had time to go to full score. So there are a lot of full scores from the earlier stuff. And then when it got into the 60s, I don't know if he just didn't care to do it. He figured that this was easier, that he was late in his writing or something like that. That he just gave the sketch. And he didn't really do, I mean, if you saw, oops, that's what I'm on. You know, he doesn't have a whole lot of instrumentation written in here. You know, so he came up with that later. You know, he wrote in piano, but, you know, this is like the tuba, and, you know, he's got the low brass coming in here, but you don't see that really. Horn ensemble, you know, he made notes to himself, but that was about it as far as orchestration. Any other questions?
How about a hand? Outstanding. Thanks so much, Ryan.
Sure, no problem. Thank you.